Ladies and gentlemen, I am very happy to be here with you tonight. I need to excuse my ambassador who unfortunately couldn't make it, but on his behalf, I would like to thank New York University for hosting us here in this beautiful place, and of course also the Goethe-Institut and Flanders House and other partners who made this evening possible. It promises to be a very stimulating, provocative, and yet even maybe explosive discussion if I look at the title there, Cartoons and Taboos Dancing in a Visual Minefield. Of course, the Belgian Embassy is very happy that one of tonight's visual minefield dancers is Steven Degryse, a Belgian cartoonist known as LECTTRR. You might want to ask him over a beer later on what it really means, but from what I gathered from our lunch yesterday, the bottom line is that he wanted it to be very complicated for others to pronounce his name. You may or may not know, but Belgium has quite a prestigious tradition in visual arts. Of course, we have the Flemish primitives, you have René Magritte with his surrealism, and also comic books and cartoons are very much part of today's vibrant art scene. With LECTTRR, we have one of these talented Belgian cartoonists here with us today. Steven explained this actually earlier, that as a teenager, he would roam around in Bruges, a meeting place for many, many artists in the past, and get inspired by all the beautiful art he saw there of Jan van Eyck, Hans Memling, and so on. And after that, he went on to the Royal Academy of Fine Arts in Ghent, one of the most beautiful cities of the world, and it's not us who just say that, it was also in the Lonely Planet. So if you want to step in Steven's footsteps, you have already two places, Bruges and Ghent, you cannot miss out on your next trip to Europe. After his studies, Steven soon grew to be a strong presence in Belgium with his daily cartoons in the Standaard, a top Belgian newspaper, but his reach goes far beyond our country with publications all over Europe, where his talent and sense of humor have been widely appreciated. In the wake of Charlie Hebdo, however, cartoons became much more than just entertaining, funny drawings. They also raise a lot of questions about freedom of speech, cultural sensitivities, and with this, I'll give the floor to Mr. Eckstein, director of the Goethe-Institut, who will introduce the other homegrown cartoonists.
Thank you very much, Carl. Welcome to this event. My name is Wilfried Eckstein. I'm the representative of the Goethe-Institut and of EUNIC here tonight. And first of all, I want to also thank the New York University and the Brademas Center for generously hosting again an event in connection with a panel series called Iconoclash. The program Iconoclash asks or puts questions into cultural and visual values and the value systems involved in the widening struggle with terrorism. In three preceding panels, we reviewed core values such as cultural heritage, the modernity, and we looked into the ideologies on the terrorist side. You remember that on 7th February last year, two terrorists attacked Charlie Hebdo, that satirical magazine in Paris. So this is, in a way, the motivation and the starting ground for the whole series. Today's panel aims at better understanding the work of cartoonists. In the Europe of the Middle Ages, and we already had some reference to earlier works, for example, jesters played an immensely important role in speaking truth out toward the king and other people in power. The jester would articulate a different perspective, a counter perspective, so to speak, a view which was unheard or unseen before the jester gave it a voice. Jesters were people with a special gift to see things differently and express them differently. By virtue of their abilities, jesters had the privilege to be heard, and they would do this in such a way that they would not be heard, hurt in that sense, and that somebody would receive that with a smile. The massacre of artists and workers at the French satirical weekly newspaper, Charlie Hebdo, a year ago, alarmed us to a new reality. That artists among us, working in our environment, can be killed for what they do, namely opening the eyes to a different way of looking at things. This tragedy of Charlie Hebdo formed the motivation for this panel and for tonight. Let me just add to what Carl said and to give honor to all those who participate in making this Iconoclash series real. I want to acknowledge at this point the EU delegation who has been hosting events with us, EUNIC, the European Union National Institutes of Culture, the British Council, the Austrian Cultural Forum, the embassies of Slovenia, Sweden, and Belgium, and today's event in particular, the House of Flanders. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to introduce our American panelists. I would like to start with Matt Wuerker. Where is he? Here is he. Matt is the staff cartoonist for Politico and has been part of the team that launched Politico in 2006. He actually started his career in an animation studio. He even did murals, and at some point in his life, he even lived on the edge of Europe, on the Canary Islands. A very nice edge, actually. Over the years, he has been constant in making primarily political cartoons. His cartoons, illustrations, and animations are published both in print and on web platforms. His work is eye-catching because it uses watercolors for his illustrations. His cartoons have been widely used in publications that range from dailies like Los Angeles Times, Washington Free Press, the Philadelphia Daily News, Christian Science Monitor, Newsweek, Nation, Smithsonian, and of course, Politico. In 2010, he was awarded the Herblock Prize at the Library of Congress and the very prestigious Berryman Award of the National Press Foundation. In 2012, he was given the Pulitzer Prize for his, quote, consistently fresh, funny cartoons, especially memorable for lampooning the partisan conflict that engulfs, that engulfs Washington. So, Matt, thank you for finding the time to join us for this panel. I would like now to introduce Anne. Anne, I thought it was differently spelled, right? Okay, good, I did it right. Anne Telnaes creates animation cartoons for the Washington Post. Before she came to DC, she used to work for Disney. In 2001, she won the Pulitzer Prize for her print cartoons, and I think it's important to mention that she was the second woman to receive that. Anne Prince's work was shown in solo exhibitions at the Great Hall in the Thomas and Jefferson Building of the Library of Congress in 2004, and this was also the year when her first book appeared. Her work has also been exhibited in Paris, Jerusalem, and Lisbon. In her cartoons on foreign affairs, she has also lampooned world leaders such as Vladimir Putin, Yasser Arafat, Ariel Sharon, and many others. She has also brought attention to the ongoing denial of women's civil and human rights. Although Telnaes has spent most of her life in the United States, she was born in Sweden, so it's a second connection to Europe, and has apparently also lived and worked abroad. This has certainly been an important experience to strengthen the role of an observer with critical eyes. She has been a member of the Cartoonist Rights Network since 2002, a point maybe we'll come back in our discussion. She has appeared in mass media, such as the European Network, Arte and BBC, in NewsHour here in the United States, NPR, C-SPAN, and so on. C-SPAN, actually quite interesting, she had an interview at C-SPAN on Charlie Hebdo. Last but not least, ladies and gentlemen, let me introduce my dear friend, Cal. Where is your paper here? Cal is the international editorial cartoonist for The Economist and the Baltimore Sun. In a distinguished career that spans 37 years, Cal has created over 8,000 cartoons in 140 magazine covers. His resume includes 6 collections of his published works, including his celebrated anthology of Economist cartoons titled Degryse Drawn. I think it's still on sale? Good, buy it. He received many prizes and acknowledgments. Last year alone, he was finalist of the Pulitzer Prize in editorial cartooning. He received both Grand Prix for Cartoon of the Year in Europe and the Hublock Prize for Cartoonist of the Year in the United States. The World Encyclopedia of Cartoons has an entry which I want to quote here. It says of Carl, commanding a masterful style, Carl stands among the premier caricaturists of the century. I think some of his cartoons, like of Anne and of Matt, are on permanent display at the Hay Adams in the bar down there, so don't miss that out. So from 1977 to 1988, Carl actually lived in the UK before he returned to the United States, where he has lived ever since. So a third position kind of linked with Europe. Tonight, Carl has volunteered to be the MC. Thank you, Carl. It's up to your floor. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Wilfred. Thank you, Wilfred. It's great to be here. First of all, it's so much fun to be with this very distinguished panel of cartoonists here, and friends as well. And what we're going to do tonight is we're going to, each of us is going to take a little bit of time to show some of their work, kind of introduce ourselves to the group visually, tell a few stories along the way. And then we're going to sit down and we're going to have a little conversation of which you guys are welcome to eavesdrop upon our chat. On a lot of the things that we've been facing, both here and abroad. And then at one point, we're going to open it up, and we would really love to get input from you. We'll open the floor for questions, and we'll make this conversation broader and hopefully deeper. Let's see how it goes. But what we're going to do first, we're going to start off with my friend Stefan here, looking for the clicker. Do you have the clicker? He has the magical clicker, and I'm going to set you up here, set up your thing. Let me get your slideshow going here.
Can you hear me? Really? Good. So I'm LECTTRR. I came all the way from Belgium. It's quite a privilege that I'm here because normally I don't do these kind of things. As a cartoonist, I think my cartoons should be strong enough for me not to have to leave the room in the morning, and I can stay in my pajamas all day and not have to go out to the other side of the world to explain my cartoons to people who have never met me before. So this is me. This is how I look after a day of work. I have been drawing all over myself. So I work for The Standard. The Standard is a quality newspaper. It's not a tabloid. It's one of the biggest quality newspapers in Belgium. By quality, we mean, of course, the cartoons and not the rest. But The Standard is, of course, very small. And this is one of the big differences with other countries and other newspapers, is that we face a lot of, as cartoonists, we face a lot of difficulties because of that. Our readership is really small. And so cartoonists do not have an in-house position or something like that. We're all freelancers. We're all subject to, we can be kicked out any day if we mess up, which I do often. So let's start with showing some of my works. Besides my editorial cartooning, I also do a lot of non-political work because I have to, because the newspaper doesn't pay me enough. And most of it is syndicated worldwide because Belgium is just not big enough for cartoons to sell. And this series is called Harakiri because people in New Zealand find it very offensive. And no, they actually changed the name in New Zealand, so. Oh, wait, I skipped one. Okay. No? Yeah, okay. So as you can see, my cartoons are very basically drawn. That's also because of the fact that I can just don't have the luxury to draw very well. I'm a very good, I'm the somewhere between Van Eyck and Albrecht Dürer is where I have to position myself. But the thing is that I have to do a lot of cartoons each day. And my cartoons, I really want them to be content-wise very good. So I spend all my time into thinking of a good joke, thinking of a good message, and none of the time goes to drawing it decently. So the drawings are mostly, when I have a cartoon and I work on it for an hour, I would work 40 or 45 minutes on the idea, and then 10 minutes on the drawing, and then 5 minutes on the color, and then 20 minutes on trying to get it mailed to the editor and being late. So even in my non-political work, I try to always be a little bit annoying. Because I think that's, it's what Wilfried just told us about the jester. It is what we cartoonists do. We're faceless. Nobody can hurt us normally, or should supposed to be. That's also one of the reasons why cartoonists do not participate in group panels mostly, normally. Are there any Muslims in the room? Religion is obviously one of the main topics I address, also politics, because I work for a political newspaper. But the things that get people annoyed are mostly the things that are interesting, because you get great jokes when you put a finger into the wound and it hurts a bit, and you get the really best jokes when you get the finger into the wound and pus comes out. So that's what I try to do, is when I get a lot of attention because of that cartoon, then I know I'm obviously doing something really good. So it's also a bit of a European tradition, I think. We don't tend to back off when you get a lot of hate mail or things like that. Actually, newspaper even like that, because it gets them attention as well. So, this one really got me into trouble. This is the cartoon I made on the day that Charlie Hebdo attacks happened, and it went worldwide, it went viral. So I have no idea how many newspapers actually reprinted it. And it got a lot of good press, really good press, and it got one really bad one, and that was, coming from an extremist Islamic corner. And we had to go into police protection and things like that. So it was actually a cartoon that changed my life for the better half. Because of that cartoon, I'm probably standing here right now. Otherwise, people outside of Belgium wouldn't have known my political work. But also, it got me into a lot of trouble. And it also got me to think a lot about the position of me as a cartoonist. Should I put that finger into that wound until pus comes out? Should I back out a little? And then the next day, I made this cartoon. This is the cartoon in which the terrorist who did the Islamic, who did the attack on Charlie Hebdo were killed. So it's important that you know that cartoonists are very potent, that we know how our ways around the bedroom. It's very. So that's why this slide is in there. when we go back to the cartoon that got me into trouble, you will notice that I didn't draw Muhammad. I never have drawn Muhammad, and I've drawn Muhammad Ali once. But I never drew Muhammad. That's really important to know, because I did get a death threat because of drawing a jihadi. So, at first, before the Charlie Hebdo attacks, the boundaries were set at drawing Muhammad. And then when everybody agreed on that you shouldn't draw Muhammad or you get killed, basically, then the boundaries were shifted into another direction. You shouldn't laugh at the warriors of God. And that is why we started making these kinds of cartoons in Belgium, where we do still laugh at these jihadis, because it is important to do, otherwise we'll end up only drawing cartoons about ourselves, about bald, elderly getting men who stay at home all day wearing pajamas drawing funny pictures. The idea of what a cartoonist is changed a lot due to Charlie Hebdo. We used to be normal people who were a bit envied because they really didn't have a real job. They were paid properly to sit at home, and they made a drawing every now and then for a newspaper, and suddenly we were freedom fighters, and we never really asked for that, because you should see me as a freedom fighter. That's not a... This one was made for the last Paris killings were the week before the climate summit in Paris. So it would have been a lot more efficient for ISIS just to be in the climate board as well as the other countries. I made this one just to show how badly I draw. It's basically just a few lines. These cartoons are really made in 10 minutes or so because I have to do a lot of cartoons every day. I make about, to make a living, I must make six published cartoons every day. That is a lot of cartoons. I make, for the newspaper alone, I have a lot of clients besides the newspaper, I make about 2,000 cartoons every year. If you would tell me that on January 1st, I would probably like cramp up and do nothing anymore. But since you just make a cartoon and then you make another one, and then when that one is finished, then you make another one, then you end up in the end with 2,000 cartoons and they're all badly drawn like this. So we laugh at the Muslims a little bit more. Oh. This one was actually ran next to a commercial for McDonald's in the Netherlands. No, it really is. That sounds funny, but that was a coincidence. I didn't get a death threat from McDonald's, though. Well, stereotypes are mainly our big weapon. It's the same all over the world. That's the one thing that every cartoonist has in common, I guess, if you're a European cartoonist or you're an Asian cartoonist or you're an American cartoonist. We just laugh at clichés, mainly. And that was it.
All right, give it up. Yeah. Stefan. Thank you. Thank you, Stefan. So after the talk today, he's going to be drawing tattoos on anyone. If you, you know, if
permanent
you get a little bit extra money. Looks like he needs it. All right, Matt, I'm going to call you up here. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Wuerker.
Okay.
Give it up.
Is this working? Can you hear me okay? I'm here representing the lazy end of the cartoon spectrum. The people that that actually have like comic strips or they have to come up with an idea for the dog or the cat every day. That takes imagination. I'm a really lazy bastard, and I sit around and I get to make fun of politicians. So, and I work in Washington, D.C., so I have the easiest job in the world. The cartoons just write themselves. And I've been doing this for 35 years professionally. My first professional cartoons were done back when Jimmy Carter was president. And the landscape has changed. The place that we work as cartoonists has changed, but the actual idea of this funny combination of a funny picture with a pun or a caricature or something hasn't changed. It really hasn't. I mean, we're political cartoonists are sort of these anachronisms that go back a couple centuries, and we're really working in pretty much, in my case, I'm working with 18th century technology like pens and brushes and watercolors and stuff like that. But the delivery system that we use has radically changed in the 35 years that I've been doing this. And tonight, the topic is talking about taboos in cartooning, and that whole question has changed so much. And a lot of it has to do with technology, but just more examples of, I mean, we have people, you know, a politician gets up in the morning and has a press conference or something like that, and the cartoons just, again, really write themselves. I love visual metaphor. where you try to capture a political dynamic with a simple drawing. In my case, I sometimes it's a pun, like we're dealing with default. Sometimes it's a metaphor. The circus metaphor is one that we keep going back to for some reason. I don't know. But back to this sort of question of the way the media landscape has changed. When I started out 35 years ago, the target for any cartoonist was to go get a job working for a daily newspaper. And cartoonists are sort of opportunistic parasites. And for like a couple centuries, the main thing for us was to find a big fat newspaper and attach ourselves to that. And in my career time, that opportunity has diminished. So we're like ticks looking for dogs to jump onto, and those dogs, the healthy dogs, were the big newspapers for a long time. And then those dogs have started to die and shrink and cut their budgets. And in the last 10, 15 years, it's that people are going freelance, people are going online. I don't think we're going away. But we're working in this really different world. And the delivery system for cartooning has actually never been better. And the reach of cartoons has never been larger or longer. This is the kind of cartoon that I like the best, the ones that are just really visual and you get them really, really quick. The thing about cartoons where you're playing with visual imagery, and we'll get to this I think in the discussion later when we talk about Charlie Hebdo and the Danish cartoon controversy, is visual metaphors are very dangerous things in this new media landscape because they travel by themselves around the world into societies where the nuance of the metaphor is lost on the audience perhaps. And the opportunity to misinterpret the cartoon or the nature of the humor is huge. And this didn't used to exist. I mean, when I started out in Portland, Oregon, back in the 70s, if you drew a cartoon for the little paper in Portland, Oregon, it stayed in Portland, Oregon. And I could draw something that would work really great for the hippies in Birkenstocks in Portland, Oregon in 1976. But maybe it didn't have to work in New York, much less London, Paris, or Lahore. How are we doing time-wise? These sort of speak for themselves. I want to get along here. Here's Grover Norquist. For those of you that follow politics and his no tax pledge, Citizens United, new labor laws in Washington, super PACs and money and everything. I mean, a lot of these are sort of evergreen topics going back to the, when Obama ran for re-election, it was a simple pitch. It was no longer hope and change. Another simple visual metaphor. But to get us here, I want to get us to the topic sort of at hand tonight. These are all visual, more political, where are we? This was all tongue-tied and everything here. The end of the Obama administration. I'm going to skip these. We'll get back to these. This is maybe the most recent cartoon that I did. One of the things that's really interesting to me, especially working at Politico, where we've been very aggressive about using social media, is cartoons work really well on social media. Twitter now uses TwitPics and stuff like that. So people share cartoons quickly across the internet. I mean, once upon a time, the biggest compliment for a cartoonist was getting cut out of the newspaper and stuck on the refrigerator door. And then the people who'd wander through the kitchen would go, oh, that's sort of funny. Well, the internet is a great big refrigerator door, and it connects to millions and millions of other refrigerator doors. So a cartoon, this one went fairly viral. And if you get a cartoon out in a timely, topical way, it spreads they spread by themselves. And then, of course, Donald Trump. I'm going to skip past these because I don't. So anyway, to the topic at hand. So the things really blew up to begin with the Danish cartoon controversy. And this gets back to that thing about a very small publication in Denmark published a group of cartoons, and then imams in Denmark took those to imams in the Muslim world, and they spread, and they basically, I've heard the term used, they basically weaponized the cartoons. They weren't great cartoons. Am I head falling apart? They weren't particularly rough cartoons even, but the people who wanted to use them as political organizing tools understood exactly how to use them. And suddenly, I love what Stephen said, suddenly cartoonists who are sitting in their basements in their pajamas doing these little drawings are turned into freedom fighters. And we're now thrust into the middle of this strange argument, this clash of civilizations, where the fundamentalists are saying, you can't say that, that's blasphemous. And the free speech side is saying, of course we can say it, there's freedom of speech. And so now the battle is joined. And it gets even crazier when the political operatives on our side start taking advantage of the situation to promote their stuff. And so after the Danish cartoon controversy, after Charlie Hebdo, I don't know how many of you remember this, the Pam Geller thing, where she said, we're going to have a show in Texas, and we're going to make it a Draw Muhammad contest. And it worked like a charm. They drew some jihadis out of Arizona who came and attacked the thing. And it was sort of the crazies fighting with the crazies, which then made me think of this, like maybe cartoonists could actually be really useful for a change, and we could just draw the terrorists out. And I used Stefan Pastis here, Pearls Before Swine, because he likes to do this in his comic strip, so I stuck him. I thought he would be the perfect bait for this one. But to me, it's a very complicated question. There was a big argument. Gary Trudeau stepped into it when he started talking about that the Charlie Hebdo cartoons were getting close to hate speech, and he pleaded for emotional intelligence. And I actually, that side of the argument resonates with me. I mean, I think that there's it's part of the political correctness argument that we've been struggling with for a long time. I mean, cartoonists have learned over the last stretch here to show some emotional intelligence in terms of the kind of imagery we use. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. I think it's actually necessary given the strange magic powers that cartoons have. It's good that we don't trade in rough ethnic stereotypes. And I understand that in the case of Charlie Hebdo, they get special dispensation because of their situation. And je suis Charlie, and I believe in that firmly, but that doesn't negate the necessity to understand the legacy of ethnic attacks using crass imagery and stuff like that. The cartoonists do have some responsibility, I think. We've come a long way in terms of the way we portray women in cartoons. So I'm in favor of emotional intelligence.
There you go. Matt Wuerker. Good job, Matt. Thank you.
You want to push this.
Thank you. Okay. Lot to chew on there. Really good stuff. Okay, Anne. Okay. Anne Telnaes is up next. You can extend your applause for Anne.
I'm going to sit because if I stand, it doesn't make a difference. I'm short. Okay. All right. So I'm going to actually take off on what you were saying. First of all, I am definitely a free speech absolutist. So just so you know, even though we're going to discuss this nicely, this is what we're going to talk about. So when I first started thinking about this whole issue about offensive images in cartoons as well as red lines, that really goes back to the Danish cartoon controversy. As was mentioned, this was in 2005 when a group of Danish cartoonists drew supposedly images of Muhammad. Now, they all weren't like that, but they were known as, depicting Muhammad in all of them. And there was widespread protests and, condemnation of these cartoonists and what they had drawn. Not just by the Muslim world. It was also, you know, some world leaders like Bill Clinton, as you see there, who called the cartoons, you know, outrageous. The UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, they call for an investigation against the Danish government for, you know, racism and disrespect for belief. You know, here in the U.S., the Danish cartoon controversy really started the ball rolling about the debate about, you know, what is it that we can actually draw? I mean, are there images that we should stay away from? So it started me thinking about, you know, other forms of censorship, you know, and what limits of free speech that, you know, we put on ourselves. You know, we have, you know, in Europe, you have laws against denying the Holocaust. In China, you know, the leaders, they severely restrict the use of the internet by their citizens. You know, and of course, the Islamic extremists, you know, they think that the appropriate response to offensive images is to kill the cartoonist. So there we are. So when we talk about red lines in cartooning, you know, what does that really mean? You know, and what are the consequences when we start making these red lines for a cartoonist about what they can draw or what they cannot draw? You know, during the debates after the Danish cartoons, the main reason given by the critics that the cartoons were offensive was the fact that they were depicting Muhammad. That was not allowed within the Islamic religion. Well, guess what? If you go back and look in history, there are plenty of examples of Muhammad being depicted in art. So, I mean, it's something to think about when people start throwing things around about what is allowed and what is not. So the debate continued after the Danish cartoon controversy. You know, we had the Swedish artist Lars Vilks draw a dog with a Muhammad head on. Of course, that, you know, ended up in threats and more condemnations. In 2012, there was an incredibly offensive and incredibly bad movie that was made about Muhammad that also ended up, I guess, causing the Benghazi attack. So, okay, fine and good, we're all arguing about it. Then, of course, in January of 2015, the debate took a very deadly turn. And, of course, as we all know, two Islamic extremists went to the offices of Charlie Hebdo in Paris and attacked and killed five cartoonists were among the dead. I believe it was 12 killed there. So at first, most of the world supported Charlie Hebdo. This is the cartoon that I did that day. It was, I have to tell you, I was shocked. I was up early, I heard the news, and it honestly took me a while to kind of wrap my head around the fact that, you know, in our small community of cartoonists, you know, five dead cartoonists was a lot. I mean, we were used to threats against cartoonists. A lot of cartoonists have been imprisoned, you know, American cartoonists don't tend to have to deal with that. But, you know, overseas, we have a lot of colleagues who have had to deal with attacks. But to have five of them killed was quite a shock. So at first, the whole world, you know, they rallied around Charlie Hebdo and cartoonist and, you know, je suis Charlie. But a couple of weeks later, then it started to change. We had some prominent writers, prominent cartoonists speaking out against what Charlie Hebdo had done. So this is a little graphic essay that I did for the Washington Post, and it reads vertically, but I'll just scroll through it real quick. Whoops. So now the shock of the murders has turned to questioning Charlie Hebdo's satire. Some cartoonists and writers have described the cartoons as anti-Muslim, blasphemous, offensive, and bigoted. The 2009 firing of a cartoonist who wrote an anti-Semitic column has also been mentioned. First of all, I'm not a big fan of bathroom humor. Jesus. Secondly, and most seriously, it's a valid discussion to have about why the divisions between people are so deep and our political discourse has become so toxic. However, this is not what we should be talking about now. The only question we should be asking is, do we condone threats or violence toward individuals because of what they say or draw, regardless of how offensive the words or images are? And I say no. Because what happens once we get beyond the easy images to condemn? And who makes that decision? Government? Religions? All people must have the right to express themselves without fear. Otherwise, we risk losing all our freedoms. Of course, the French didn't extend their free speech rights to some other people after the Charlie Hebdo attacks. There was a famous comedian that decided to show his solidarity with one of the Islamic extremist attackers. And of course, he was arrested because they have hate speech laws in France. So I'm going to show you some cartoons that got me in trouble. and I was very happy to see when I collected them that I'm insulting every major religion in the world. So my first one was in 2002. So this was right after 9/11. You know, and of course the United States has a very close relationship with Saudi Arabia, which I find quite ironic since, you know, the way that they view women and their rights is very different from how we view women and rights. So this is the cartoon that I did in response to that. This one resulted in a couple of death threats. So, you know, we get threats. This was a little different. You know, the FBI was involved. They traced it back to Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. That's okay, as long as they're not in the United States, I'm fine with that. The next one that I had was in 2003. As you might remember, the Boston Catholic Church sexual abuse scandal broke in 2002. And I, along with many of my colleagues, did many, many cartoons criticizing the Catholic leadership for their inaction to bring priests to justice, to make sure that they weren't going out and abusing more children. So this is a technique that cartoonists do where they take one topic and then they use it to comment on another one. So what I did is in the July of 2003, the Vatican issued a statement condemning same-sex marriages. So I thought that was quite ironic, and so I put the two together and said, we reject legalizing same-sex unions. On the other hand, illegal same-sex unions. That's okay. It wasn't appreciated. It ran in the Minneapolis Star Tribune, and of course it started getting lots of letters to the editor, as well as a lovely little op-ed piece by the chancellor of the Archdiocese of St. Paul in Minneapolis, who basically called me that I was anti-Catholic. Whoops. Okay, this next one is an animation, so it's going to have sound. Stop at some point. Okay, so this one was in response to the 2014 Gaza bombings that you might remember, you know, and quite a few children were killed, Palestinian children were killed. So what I was trying to do here was comment on the actions of the Israeli government, you know, how they decided to respond to this. I didn't think much about this cartoon. I did this on the weekend, you know, I figured, I was so proud of myself, I came up with a cartoon that didn't involve blood. You know, I didn't think any of it. And then all of a sudden, Monday rolls around and I start getting some interesting tweets in reaction to it, as well as emails. And then come to find out that my editor has been getting really nasty phone calls from Jewish special interest groups. And then the Jerusalem Post runs a piece on it, talking about how the Jewish groups are saying that it's anti-Semitic. I'm criticizing the Israeli government. It's not anti-Jewish, it's about the Israeli government's action. Of course, they didn't bother contacting me for any statement on it. They just went ahead and wrote that story. So that was another one that I had. And then this last one was recent. And it's an animated GIF. Whoops. The Ted Cruz campaign. You might recall the Ted Cruz campaign had a Christmas video where they parodied certain holiday book classics. And you know, normally, editorial cartoonists do not comment on the children of candidates, and I do not either. However, this video, if you watch the entire video, Ted Cruz actually has one of his eldest daughter read from the script of a political attack ad. I mean, she's actually reading it. Unfortunately, the media, when they were reporting the story, didn't bother showing that part. They just showed Ted Cruz reading. So, of course, that fit in very well with the narrative about how the cartoonist was attacking the children and making the children out to be monkeys. Totally missed the whole visual metaphor of an organ grinder. And this resulted in an amazing response. I have never had such an avalanche of tweets and emails that went on for days and days and days. It took me 4 days to go through my emails just to see what in the hell was in there. I found some threats which were concerning. Most of them were just disgusting. You know, as any woman that deals with online stuff, I cannot tell you how many times I was called a cunt. And I'm going to say that word because we tend to gloss over it. But I had, that was the normal response to me. And I don't think those people should be thrown in jail, but I think that people should realize that happens. And the last thing I'm going to show you is just, what did I do?
Oh, do you want me to get that back up?
Yeah, real quick. Yeah, I just wanted to show.
I'll have to take it. I'm going to run you through it.
No, you know what? It's all right. We can.
You keep on talking. I'll get.
Okay. The last one I'm going to show is just kind of going on with what Matt showed an earlier cartoon. I want to just kind of show how sexism has not changed since the early 20th century. So on the left there, when women were trying to get the right to vote, I love these. The origin and development of a suffragette. At 15, a little pet. At 20, a little coquette. At 40, not married yet. Uh-oh. At 50, a suffragette, and she's ugly. And of course, anytime they drew suffragettes who have never been kissed, they always attack the women's appearance. We've come so far. No, we haven't. Look over here. These are two cartoons that are recent. Young women's values class, plan A, responsibility, family planning, self-esteem, keeping a good reputation. Plan B, the chance to act like a drunken whore. And look, the student that amazingly looks like the teacher, that she's eventually going to be as ugly as the teacher, says, Plan B sounds so liberating. So guess what? If you're a woman that wants to just decide for herself what her sexual life is going to be, you're going to end up ugly. And then down here, a justice, Justice Kagan. Finally, a court pick that best reflects the average American woman. And the little buttons say, never married, no kids, boys are icky, and baby killer. And look, she's ugly. So yes, we've come very, very far.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ann Telnaes. Thank you, Ann. A lot to chew on there. Okay, now let's see if I can find the cow cartoons here. So far, this has been so interesting. I cannot wait to hear what you guys got to say. So I'm just going to bomb through some stuff real quickly here so that we can get into the conversation.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The thing there. So this is me. I guess we're going to go this direction here. Am I going the right way? Ah, yes. So I'm a cartoonist who works in two different major markets. So I work the Economist magazine as a global publication. Appears in every country around the world. And so one of the things about it is that I'm looking at two different audiences. But I also work for the Baltimore Sun, which is a domestic American market that deals with the local, regional, and of course, US subjects. And the sensibilities of the audiences are quite different. And I lived and worked in the UK for 11 years. And so I had some interesting experience working as a cartoonist there as well. So Over the years, I've done Republicans and Democrats, a vice president here, a Republican vice president, and a Democratic vice president here. So a lot in the realm of caricature. And of course, American presidents. Barack Obama, of course, was an interesting challenge that the cartoonist we faced, talking about taboos. He was a black president. How do you deal with a black politician, whether they look beautiful like the first time or after 5 years when their face starts to take a little bit more wear? Election time is a great time to be a cartoonist here in this country. We're dealing with these things. This is the bread and butter for what we do. These are the non-controversial on the whole, except that the one thing that we all are going to share is that our job is mainly a negative job. We are constantly on the attack. We don't do cartoons that are positive cartoons. That comes across as sort of sycophantic. We're really kind of critics. Here's one here. She said, the donkey's saying, I wasn't sure about this candidate at first, but now she's growing on me. And the elephant says, he's growing on me too, only he's a tumor. Okay? There we go. So anyways, we do have controversy. I'm just going to just show you a few subjects that areas that do tend to get us in trouble more than others when you're working in the U.S. market. And it is something that we don't shy away from subjects, but you know that when you tackle one of many taboos or sensitive areas or pus-filled arms in America, you're going to get reactions, okay? And one of them is religion, clearly religion. Here's a cartoon on that subject. So, hello, Lord Almighty's office. Michael the Archangel speaking. May I help you? Voice from offstage says, who is it? Pope John Paul II on the line. Again? He's worried about this movement to ordain women as priests. But I've already told him what I think. Tell him I'm busy. I'm sorry. Oh, I'm sorry. She's busy right now. Okay, so this cartoon, not so controversial, but it's a sort of, you can almost feel the temperature rising when they are going from panel to panel when you're dealing with anything with religion. You know something crazy is going to happen. So this cartoon was on the cover of The Economist when Indira Gandhi was president of India, and when it's her as the god Kali, and when it arrived into the airports, they were all confiscated and burned. All of them were destroyed because of it deemed to be an offensive image on the cover of the magazine. So one of the things that we also forget when we're in this conversation is a recent report put out by Freedom House, which is a press watchdog group, said that only 15% of the population of the world lives in a place where there's freedom of the press. 15%. Okay. So in some ways, the conversation we're having is kind of in that realm, because the other 85%, this thing happens. There's no chance of drawing your own head of state. There's no chance of doing all this other stuff. Newspapers won't print it. There's a great deal of intolerance when it comes to all that stuff. So religion, the subject at hand, of course, here is mostly about dealing with Charlie Hebdo and Islamic extremists. The guys on the left say, they say we Muslims no longer need to live under the thumb of Western imperialists. And instead, there's somebody else's thumb you live under. So again, this is a strong subject that you need to treat, you need to touch. But obviously, whenever you start to dance in this minefield, curious things can happen. In fact, you can get so frustrated sometimes, it all seems a little bit like this. It's a post-apocalyptic scene, and there's two dogs, one saying to the other, oops. It all started with an argument over whose God was more peace-loving, kind, and forgiving. Okay? It can feel like that sometimes. So another big subject, of course, in America is guns. Guns is a very big subject here. You do any cartoon on that subject, whether you're in Texas, and earlier we were talking about one of our colleagues who worked in Texas for many years, and she would do many gun cartoons. You get yourself a lot of troubles. But in Baltimore, we have the same thing. So anyways, I had a situation. I lived in the UK for 11 years, as mentioned. And in the UK, there's no guns, virtually no guns. And so it's a palpable difference living in a society where that's the case. So I do a lot of gun cartoons. So anyways, I'm in Lebanon recently, right? So I'm with these Lebanese cartoonists. And I'm showing him the cartoons. And one guy says, hey, Cal, you know, you do all these cartoons about guns. Aren't you worried? Because all the guys who don't like those cartoons, they've all got guns. So anyways, before I could even, you know, conjure an answer, one of the other Lebanese cartoonists puts his hand up and says, ah, it's the same thing here in Lebanon, except we've all got rocket launchers. So it made me feel just a little bit better. So anyways, just as Anne pointed out, Arab-Israeli relations. You do subject on Arab-Israeli relations, guarantee that you're going to get pushback on it, no matter what it says, pretty much. And you can get yourself in an awful lot of trouble. But you still have to pursue those cartoons anyways. And then there's also racial stereotypes. Now, this is George Bush. And I show this cartoon. This is a cartoon that was an illustration for The Economist about K Street lobbyists, okay, and how they were kind of, you know, running the show in the White House for a little bit of a while, it seemed. But now, imagine if that was Barack Obama. Right? Different story. We know that. We draw this in the United States. The image of an African American as a primate is a no-go area. So all societies have their taboos, very strong taboos. Now, there's also the idea of racial and ethnic stereotypes. So here's a cartoon I did called The Tainted Elections Club. It's got, you know, Iran, Afghanistan, and Zimbabwe. And there's Mugabe saying, I think we should elect a chairman, but that could get tricky, okay, in this group. But here you have, you know, very strong, exaggerated caricatures. They could go into the realm of offensive stereotypes. So where is the line? Where do you go there? Another area that you have to be treading on very carefully when you're in this business. All right, then there's another one here. Here's choice. You can see the donkey and elephant both have choice signs, but the donkey is choice for abortion, and the elephant's choice for schools, right? Anyways, abortion. Abortion is related to religion, but any of these kind of culture war areas you get in there, people get really excited and agitated. And of course, the thing is, one of the things that I think worries me most when working in America is not the concern about Muslim extremists like our friends in Europe are having to deal with today, but it's more about some one guy with a gun, with lots of guns, remember, who takes particular offense at a cartoon. That, to me, is the most worrying thing. And then there's sex, okay? So, you know, the Monica Lewinsky thing came on board, and that suddenly made a big challenge for the world of cartoonists and others. And one of the things we don't draw, partly because society understands, is we live in a society where we have family newspapers mostly. And so they're not going to draw graphic sexual imagery in the United States. Other countries, when I was working in the UK, you could use a lot more graphic sexual stuff, but there's still a taboo here in the United States for that. And this may be one of my last cartoons. So when Bill Clinton got... when the Senate freed him up and he wasn't totally impeached, O.J. gives him the thumbs up from it, and this is a cartoon that has both sex and race in it at the same time. This got tons of reaction from people who thought it was offensive. So anyways, this last cartoon is my homage to our friends in Paris a year ago. So on the day when I, like Anne and like and all of us cartoonists, when we heard the news of this, it was such a shocking thing, because we in our business, we're in the business of trying to take on intolerance, take on hate. Basically, that's kind of the place we are. And we use humor, we use pictures, that's kind of our mode. But on that day, we lost. Okay, and that day, it looked like those people who could to take out a few bodies, take out a few of us cartoonists, but they were slightly mistaken when they did it because they thought they could actually take out satire as well, take on our humor. And I have a feeling that they can try and they can try and they can try, but at the end of the day, we'll get the last laugh. All right. So, all right, I'm just going to pull up the last kind of background slide here, and then we're going to start up our conversation. So, you know, there were so many good things that we talked about and that people introduced. One of the things that, in the past year, we've had so many conversations like this, right? I mean, people have been having roundtable discussions, but mostly for us, it's been amongst Americans, okay? And I was really interested hearing when you were talking, before we met, you're talking about what it's like to be the Belgian cartoonist, how their lives have changed in the past year.
Well, yes, of course, everybody was worried. Paris is really close. It's a 2-hour drive or something like that. So The last Paris attacks, in which no cartoonists were involved, were done by terrorists who hid in Brussels. So that's not a very reassuring thought. But there's also the sentiment somehow that, well, these Islamic threats or the fact that you can't portray anything that you would like to portray anymore is in the back of our heads, but we still face a lot of other issues that can be more threatening to cartooning. So we get reminded to it every now and then, and it's still, but it's also reunited us more. So there were a lot of, like you showed in the last cartoon, there's a lot of plus points to it for us. Mm. We used to be all individual cartoonists. Now we grouped up and we work together. We have a gallery now. We do things together. We put things on the agenda with our newspapers. That's what we started doing. Before that, we were just all people sitting at home drawing cartoons, and that was it. We were just making money, basically. Mm. And now we discuss topics. We discuss, should we draw Muhammad? What do we do with this? We disagree on it, obviously. Everybody has a different point of view, but still we are talking about it. And that's the main thing that changed, that we are engaged in a discussion. And but the freedom fighter thing, that's dangerous. We have become celebrities. So the fact that we were anonymous before, we all had a nom de plume, LECTTRR is not my real name. That is somehow a way for us to hide from the general public. That's why we work at home. We don't work in a television studio. That's why we normally don't do this kind of talks. We just, it empowers us to be anonymous. Mm. And by becoming celebrities, being asked to talk about Charlie Hebdo on television, things like that, that takes away our power as being outsiders. We need to be outsiders. You need to be not part of the, of not part of society is maybe a bit strong, but we need not to be part of the news. We need to be the ones speaking in so we can say anything we want. But the moment you're part of it yourself, you're no longer being objective.
Yeah, I remember you said something about that you had some cartoon colleagues who were thinking of packing it in.
Yes.
Because after the Charlie
well,
Hebdo thing?
The thing is that most cartoonists are getting older really fast. I mean, the Belgian cartoon community is not the youngest in the world. And these people are just on the 5 years or 10 years away from retirement. And they had the golden years, so they had the good times. And for them, it's no longer worth to pursue it in this kind of situation where you could get killed for any cartoon you're making, because these boundaries shift really fast. It starts with not drawing Muhammad, then it starts with not drawing jihadis, and all of a sudden some right-wing nut also considers that, well, if they get offended and they can shoot, well, then if I get offended, then I can shoot. And a lot of that discussions went back and forth because we felt, or a lot of people felt, that it was just no longer worth doing. But nobody stopped in the end. But there was a lot of serious thought in.
Mm. Now, one of the things you mentioned was that you had cartoons discussing amongst mm-hmm. themselves. I think mm-hmm. one thing that people who are not in the cartoon community assume that we all kind of are in the same place. Everyone's kind of agrees in this. But there's a lot of difference of opinion. So I'm curious, how would you guys describe the differences of opinion or you know, from the fall and the fallout, what's been going on? You mentioned the Trudeau thing. Where do people kind of fall down generally? Where's the breakdown?
I think that one thing that's one of the puzzles that's presented to cartoonists by this stuff, and also by what I keep referring to as sort of the new media landscape, is there are sort of two reactions. One is I think that a lot of cartoonists maybe became a little more careful about what they were drawing. There was maybe more self-censorship going on. At the same time, there were other people that stopped and realized that if I do something provocative here, I can raise my visibility and actually promote my career. And so there are people who opportunistically take advantage of this stuff, like you mentioned Lars Vilks in Sweden. I mean, he wasn't a guy that had a legacy of doing political cartoons. He was a conceptual artist, and he took advantage, or and continues to take advantage of the situation. And I think you have to be, the readership and the public has to be able to stop and differentiate that way. I mean, it's true with cartooning in general. There are cartoonists that their whole MO is provocation for provocation's sake. Mm-hmm. You know, really sticking, as you say, sticking the finger in the wound and whatever, because that's how you get attention and you become the focus of the conversation. And, you know, it's a good tactic in some ways. I'm not sure it actually contributes to the conversation in a constructive way. I mean, I do think that there are red lines where it's like, you know, the old cliche about bringing more light than heat to a conversation. There is a point where you are just, you are throwing gas on the fire, or you are doing, you're not elevating the debate. And I don't think it's a bad thing to expect people who are in the public square participating in the media to actually try to elevate the debate as opposed to just provoke conflict and fights. I mean, you even see it on cable television, you know, the cable news shows, it's a shtick. And I think part of the paralysis of Washington and American politics is the media is to be blamed, because the easy route is, let's promote conflict, even if it's superficial or crazy, because that attracts eyeballs and attention. Mm. And that people turn into money. Mm.
And you had a few controversial cartoons, but clearly when you're doing your cartoons, you're not trying to get eyeballs. You're not doing it to guy about you. Yeah. You're just doing what you're doing. Does it surprise you how people respond and things like that?
Oh yeah, and I mean that's the thing for me. I mean, in principle I understand what you're saying, but I want to be able to have that tool, because like you said, you know, my MO is not to just find a really controversial, you know, image to use so I get eyeballs to my cartoons. But if I'm commenting on a subject matter that I feel very strongly about, I want to be able to use that harsh image,
right,
because I want to make a point.
And you want to bring some heat.
Absolutely, yeah, because I think there's certain topics that deserve that. Now, unfortunately, and we should probably talk about this, is, you know, this is fairly recent too. You know, the whole thing about social media now has definitely changed the landscape for us. I mean, I experienced it personally with the Cruise cartoon. I have never seen anything take off so fast, so harshly than that reaction to that. I mean, and it was a combination of things. It was a combination of the social media, the quickness of it, frankly, the Cruise campaign, which was incredibly well organized, you know, my editor's decision. It was just everything all at once. So I think as cartoonists, we're going to have to realize that. And it's not, we'll have to consider it when we're doing a cartoon. We'll just have to consider what the reaction is going to be. Because unfortunately, now with social media, everyone can see it. Mm. And as has been discussed, you know, there's different images in different societies that have different meanings, that people take it differently. And when you have a lazy media that does not exactly explain visual media, visual metaphors, then you have that added problem. So it's everything that we all, it's just more, I mean, that we have to consider.
I mean, we're living in an era when there were sort of, there's this outrage industry, or people that understand how to harness outrage. In a certain sense, the Danish cartoons were an example of that, where the jihadi, the fundamentalists in the Middle East went, oh, this is a great political tool. And in the same way, ironically, Anne does the great cartoon with Ted Cruz, and Ted Cruz's people go, we know exactly how to use this, and how much money did he raise off your cartoon?
They raised money on it, right?
More than I'll ever make in my life.
Yeah, like millions of dollars, and they sort of, so they rev up the outrage machine and stuff.
Yeah.
And it's a weird place to be.
Stephanie, social media is an issue. I mean, because one of the things about newspapers, they sometimes like traffic.
Social media is actually a bigger threat to cartoons than Islamic terrorists. No, it really,
really
is, because if you come to think of it, the Islamic threat we can handle. I mean, it's a debate, it's culture. These cultures will, there's always going to be extremists in every voice. I mean, you have extreme right wing as well. Mm. So these kinds of things will always be there. But social media has changed the game completely. There used to be a media, and it was made out of professionals. All these people have a deontological code. They were thinking about what they were doing. They were well educated in being part of the media. They knew what message they were sending out and how there would be, what kind of responses there would be. And nowadays, everybody who buys a smartphone has become the media. So there are like 10 billion people out there being media. And these people are no longer thinking about what we are broadcasting. We are just figuring it out as we go along. And the result is that critical voices are being swamped by this huge tsunami of cat videos and people falling from stairs and things like that. So when you put out a really good and critical cartoon, for instance, or journalistic piece, or and you put it out there, and normally 40 years ago or something like that, it would have had serious impact on society. The possibility is just there that the moment when it was tweeted was wrong, that some cat did something funny, and the entire critical debate is lost in this huge pile of crap.
So we got to use more cats. We have to use
more cats. Yeah, exactly. More cats.
More really cute funny cats.
Terrorist cats.
Well, I just want to touch on one thing, and then we're going to open the floor for questions from folks here. You gave a talk last night, and you had a really interesting quote about religion, because I think that we've probably, if you went back over time, religion in all its different forms has been a big head butter with cartoons mm-hmm. and images.
Religion is about giving answers, mm-hmm. and cartoons is about asking questions. So it's obvious that it's going to be conflict all the time. So religion doesn't want questions, and we don't want answers.
And I think there's another aspect of that, especially in the United States. I mean, for me, in cartoons, I mean, religion, a person's own personal religious convictions, I'm not going to cartoon on that. But the problem is, in the last several years, you know, there's many religious organizations that want to get in the political debate. You know, they want to have their say in how politics is run. They want their say in policies, which affect all of us, regardless if we're religious or not. So now I feel as though it's kind of opened it up a little bit. So that's the added problem, is it's not that cartoonists are just dying to, you know, criticize religions. That's not it. It's part of the political dialogue now, and that's what we do. So now we're having an extra layer on it. Mm.
Interesting. Well, great. Well, we're going to open the floor for some questions. We do have a gentleman who's got a microphone. So if you have your question, put your hands up. We'll get the mic there, because we want all the people who are watching this being streamed to be able to get your brilliant words. We've got our first question there, and then we'll come to you, sir.
Thank you, Herb Rose. I recall that when the cartoon first came out in Eulenspostin, the sanity quotient was a little bit different than it's become. Because there was a boycott in some of the Arab countries of Danish products. And my sister-in-law, who is Danish, told me that at the time, initially sales went down, but then they started to boom as far as Danish hams went around the world. So people were compensating for the original boycott. What I wonder, though, is the artist who drew the cartoon, what is his situation currently? It's been a while, and I heard that he might have gone into hiding at some point, but I wonder if any of you know what his situation is.
The turban one, you mean?
Yes.
So there was 11 cartoons drawn, right? By 10 cartoonists, is right? So usually people consider them all, but there's one cartoon in particular, and Matt actually is going to see if he can, I think he's got an image of it. So there's one cartoon that everyone knows or seen that seems to embody the situation. I don't know the specifics about him, but people often get confused about all the various different cartoons, because there's been some other cartoonists who've gotten in trouble. Do you know any more
stuff? Actually, it was some kind of experiment by the newspaper.
Yeah.
They just invited a lot of people who were working in the visual field. Some of them aren't real cartoonists.
That's right. Yeah.
That's not the right one. Just to see if they would do it, actually, if they would draw the profit.
That's right.
And they ended up publishing it, and there was no response at the...
That cartoonist, he's not in hiding, but he's under protection.
I think they're all under protection.
Yeah,
right?
They're still under protection.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they...
And it's the one in the upper right-hand corner that most people know.
Yeah, the turban one.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. There you go, that's the one. We've got a gentleman here who has a question in front, right there. That's him. Yep. And then we'll come over to you.
Hi. Yeah. Thanks a lot for your all's discussion. It's really interesting, and your work is beautiful. Great stuff. From your comments, it seems like there's somewhat of a difference of opinion about how you approach the getting up to a taboo in your work. And I'm just curious, have you ever done a cartoon that you thought, wow, this is great, and then you just decide, well, I really shouldn't publish that?
Well, I'll first say that one of the interesting things, I guess, that's kind of missed in this conversation is that we all have to go through editors. And we have newspapers that have their own reputation, their own ideas of what should be published, not. So we can have all the best ideas in the world. Of course, we've got thousands of great ideas that never make it. But the idea is that that goes through that filter, and they take some responsibility, obviously, what goes through. So what happens is that I know, particularly when you work in a domestic American paper like the Baltimore Sun, they're very sensitive about local people's reaction to things, and so they're gonna put up some red flags beforehand, and they won't put something through. Particularly when it comes to race relations. In Baltimore, we know this, the issues that have been going on in the city, and so that when you delve in that area, you have to kind of tread a little bit more carefully. Does anybody else have any? Do you have any examples?
If I wanted, I could draw Muhammad, but they will never publish Tintin, because Tintin has a very good law firm.
Uh-huh. So right.
It's a taboo. It's a big taboo in Belgium.
You can't even use it as a metaphor.
No, I see he's printed on the banner in the back. I hope the Kingdom of Belgium did ask them, because otherwise you'd be in trouble. And big trouble. So that's a big taboo. And I made a cartoon about it as well, that I can draw Muhammad, but I can't draw Tintin. So we all have our taboos, and it's everywhere. Mm. And sometimes we judge the Islamic world for saying, well, we should be able to have freedom of speech and do everything we want, but we're doing it ourselves all the time. We're hiding behind laws and behind rules and behind, the result is that we stop thinking for ourselves. We hide behind the law and behind a lot of rules all the time, even in the West.
Yeah, I know that an Irish cartoonist friend of mine was saying that for a long time, probably maybe it's a little bit different now, you can never do the Pope. I mean, you just could never draw the Pope in Ireland. And then, of course, in Israel, they have a military censor. You know, the cartoons, some cartoons have had their stuff axed, and they have to be kind of wary of basically security. And what does security mean? It could be broad.
I mean, speaking for the Americans in here, we're very lucky, and oddly enough, the person we have to thank for our great position here is Larry Flint,
is our patron
saint of,
you go, Larry.
Of free speech, because Falwell sued him 25 years ago over a political satire in Hustler magazine, and it went all the way to the Supreme Court. And under that umbrella of that Supreme Court decision that basically says, yes, public figures, you have every right to parody them, and they can't sue you.
Yeah, and Falwell's team, what they were going on was the fact that the parody that the ad parody that Flint did was caused emotional distress.
Yeah.
So if you can imagine, if we had not won, every single cartoon we do
hopefully
could have caused
emotionally.
I mean, it really
probably
was.
Probably be sitting here alone then.
That's right. I get emotional distress drawing my own cartoons.
I mean, we really do owe a lot to that. To that opinion.
We do, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Smutkettles.
Really.
It's a bedrock, and it's a sample for the rest of the world. We have a question over here. Do we have a mic nearby? Ryan?
Hi. Well, I think it's because of Belgium being the center of the EU, I can say there's a tendency, or certainly preference in the EU, to homologize across modalities. So just a little bit of German law, Grundgesetz, and both an uncle, a band that once said that we're going to go to France and kick the crap out of the French. And ever since, that's illegal. So in that context, how do we ask for a privilege for cartoonists over bands, over any other expression that could be censored and sanctioned under at least German law and possibly EU law? I think also of the guy that was giving the kind of faux Nazi salute.
Well, bands do get groupies and cartoonists don't, so we get the free speech then. That's And we get the free speech then, so. No, but if you, as a cartoonist, if you would deny the Holocaust in Belgium, you would probably go to jail. So that every country has certain rules and certain, that there's no way around. So it's the same for bands as it is for cartoonists. These are specific taboos and rules that apply, and you have to obey them. Doesn't mean you can't question that law that is in place, and that is something that obviously happens a lot. But does that answer your question?
Except for it make consistent across modality.
Yeah, well, there are already differences between two cartoonists, so there's no way that anything is going to be equal.
We were discussing this a little bit yesterday, and Stefan was saying that I mean, he made a really good point. The problem with hate speech laws is that if you make it illegal, you force that kind of conversation underground, and it sort of metastasizes. It's better to let bigotry and stupidity speak for itself, mm-hmm. and have people respond to it, like in the public square. I mean, I think that we're fortunate in the U.S. in that we don't really have hate.
We have no hate speech laws.
So it's better to bring it out in the open, air it, and let stupidity speak for stupidity.
Yeah.
I also think it's really interesting that Stefan steps out of his pajamas, shows up here, and now he represents all of the European Union.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Amazing.
I think and you're a freedom fighter.
Yeah. Yeah. Also.
There was a
really good. Another question. Yes, right down here.
I was wondering where you get your inspiration to produce the cartoons. Do you read newspapers? Do you have conversations? Where does your thought and your creativity come from?
Anne, we'll start with you.
Well, like most cartoonists, I mean, yeah, we love to read the news. We get up and that's the first thing we'll do. I mean, I'll listen to the radio, I'll watch TV, I'll go online, check my Twitter feed. It's an ongoing thing. It really is just all day long. You sketch little ideas in your sketchbook. You figure out later on what you're really going to do. You start looking at your deadline clock, and you're like, okay, I really need to make a decision now. And then when you finally decide what you're going to draw, that's when you usually have, 20 minutes left? And then you go. But it's an ongoing thing. You really can't be in this business unless you really enjoy doing this. If you enjoy, the political landscape. I did not get... I was not interested in politics in my 20s. I didn't read newspapers, but when I was up late doing cartoons, just generic cartoons, I actually watched the Tiananmen Square massacre unfold right in front of my eyes. And that had such an effect on me that I decided I wanted to start using my artwork as a platform. So I think everybody has a different way of getting into it, but you have to have the passion for it.
Matt.
All that, everything Anne just said, the hot spur of a deadline really focuses your mind. I've had this weird experience, though, over the last number of years, maybe 5-6 years, where maybe my poor brain has been trained to think in terms of cartooning, but my best ideas are there when I wake up in the morning. It's the weirdest damn thing. I'm literally dreaming up cartoons. And then I'll wake up and there'll be like a funny connection of like, that water cooler thing from the era of segregation? That's Flint. And it's like literally there as I'm waking up. And so I've learned to really pay attention to whatever I was
dreaming. You're sleepwalking.
I guess. I don't know. Yeah, it's very weird.
Inspiration.
Well, the same as Anne, but plus the despair and the self-loading and the complete, the self-destructive ideas of, my creative process is waking up in the morning without having any good dreams. And then, it's amazing. And then I start to think, and then I have 8 more hours or something like that. Then I have a lot of time, and I just am completely unable to do anything productive, and I keep walking around and getting frustrated, and then by the time it gets 7 o'clock, my deadline is at 8, then I get the idea that I still have to do 12 more cartoons, And then things start off, and then I'm really glad that everything worked out, and I'm a genius, and everything is perfect, and it's the best cartoons in the world, and then they go to print on time, and the next morning they're utter crap. and that's my creative process.
Right, we're very organized. We do this really in an organized fashion.
So the dreaming sequence, there's a cartoonist named Bill Brown who's telling a story how he would come up with ideas at night, but he could never remember them in the morning.
Oh.
So one day, what he decided to do was that he got a tape recorder, okay? So he put it by his bed, and in the middle of the night, during that kind of special moment between, you know, sleep and cognizance, he dreamed up something. He didn't want to wake up his wife, so he very surreptitiously went down, he turned on the tape, he got into it, and then the next morning he woke up, he says, oh yes, that idea, and he turns on the tape, and he says, it was a raving lunatic. in my room last night. I don't know how that happened. Yeah. But one of the things that another colleague of ours named Tom Myers once said, that what he looks for, what gives him inspiration, is when he's reading the newspaper and whatever makes him shoot his Cheerios out through his nostrils in frustration. That's what he gives him target for. But really, I think what it is that it's going to sound terribly like Miss America's, is that you want to change the world, you want to make the world a better place. You do it in a way that we really enjoy, which is drawing and then using humor, and hopefully it can contribute to the conversation. Although we're having to deal with it in a negative art form, and we have to dance in minefields. This is a very delicate thing. But we go into it, you don't go into this half-heartedly, you go into it with a full passion. And there's very few people who can meet the deadlines consistently. I mean, the whole idea of turning out 6 cartoons a day is amazing.
Mm-hmm. But they're badly drawn, so.
That's right. But he's been drawing this morning. He's been drawing this whole time when he's here. You know, you're working the whole time.
Because I have to, because the newspaper won't shut down for a week.
Yeah,
so.
And so
I asked them.
Yeah. So it's a special craft with unique characters involved within, and we all love hanging out with each other because they're so cool. Maybe a couple more questions. I don't know how we're doing for time. Let us know how long we go on for. We'll go here, and then we're going to go way back there. Okay.
Hi, thank you so much for sharing your craft with us and all the background. I think it's always really hard to discuss your creative process when you're a creative person, so thank you for that. Question for you, and you touched on it a bit. So here we are now, generations are coming of age who have grown up solely on social media, you know, unlike most of us in this room, if I can say that. And it's a very, very different thing, and I'm wondering kind of what your thoughts are about that, and if there are cartoonists that you know of who are kind of in their 20s, who are millennials, who are coming up, who, and I don't want to say this because it sounds awful, but actually have something to say, because I think a really big piece of social media is you can express your opinion and no one's going to necessarily disagree with you. Mm-hmm. And if you want to, you can find a forum where you can keep expressing your opinion and everybody's going to agree with you. It's not like when we were in school and you went to debate class. You know, I mean, it's a very different format. So I'm just wondering if you had thoughts on that and like what the connection you think might be between the 20-somethings doing graphic novels and maybe, you know, stepping away from cartooning and all that.
Because we mentioned here two really negative view of social media and your personal experience, but there's got to be some positive, there's some positive ways that this can be built. I mean, the first thing that comes to mind is that there's a lower barrier to entry. And we all know when we are trying, how many newspapers are there in Belgium?
In the Dutch-speaking part, in which I can work for, maybe 5.
Yeah, 5. And so, in the days before social media, if somebody was aspiring, wanted to be, and believe me, all the people who had jobs, and nobody wanted to give those jobs up, you couldn't get in. Mm-hmm. So now, you have an opportunity, low barrier to entry. We're seeing it in music, we're seeing it in film, we're seeing it in other things.
Also, it's global. That's
right,
important.
And it's global.
Well, and there are a number of web comics out there that are hugely successful, and they're completely independent. The cartoonist will put them up there; they'll attract, a million Twitter followers, and then
With Patreon, they get paid
Patreon, or they'll do a book through Kickstarter or something like that, and they're like they have big audiences and are making a good living and stuff. The part that's interesting is usually those are not political, and I'm kind of amazed. I'm sort of waiting. I think that there's a lot of talent out there that doesn't quite get that there's this funny little niche of political cartooning where you can have an impact and be part of the political conversation. I'm frankly amazed that there aren't more millennials that are trying out, say, short animations like what Anne does, or other forms of things that you could put up on social and attract a following.
Yeah, I think one of the problems, I mean, at least that I noticed, I recently went to an animation festival in LA and talked to actually a group of young animators, and you know, a lot of them, they're not even aware of editorial cartooning because they didn't grow up with newspapers,
right.
So they didn't see a daily editorial cartoon. And you know, I think it's just basically us getting the word out to them that that is there. And as Matt said, now we have the internet. There are so many different mediums you could be doing this in. You know, you could be doing the long form. You could be doing still the single panel. You could be doing it in animation.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just wondering if maybe it's more of a question of, you know, we need to reach them and say, you know, there is this form of art that you can do where you can express an opinion. They're just not aware of it because they didn't grow up with newspapers.
Or it's also changing. I mean, you know, this thing that you see on social all the time, the little memes, the someone takes a photograph and it's a political
kind of
cartoon. It's just not drawn. They grab a photo, they add a funny cheeky punchline, and then they spread it around.
Wait a minute, you don't have to draw?
Yeah.
Oh boy, 20 extra minutes.
Yeah.
So another great thing that I think social media has helped is that, you know, one of the things about when you're a cartoonist is that there's no school for cartooning.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we've all kind of learned from watching those who passed on before, but we're also lucky living in Western societies that have a tradition of cartooning. Mm-hmm. Many other societies do not have a history tradition of cartooning.
Mm-hmm.
And what social media has done is allowed many young cartoonists to learn from us who are practicing mostly in the West.
Mm-hmm.
And then they, you know, there are forums, there's groups they can see and they probably are growing exponentially in their style. I know that when I was starting off, when we were learning, we'd have to get books of other cartoonists. The only way we'd learn. But now on the web, you just learn so much because all the styles are there.
Now, we were joking earlier. If only Al Qaeda and ISIS had decided when they'd set their sights on Charlie Hebdo, with a slightly different strategy. If they, instead they'd set up training camps in the mountains of Pakistan or whatever to train a special squad of highly trained cartoonists that they then send to Paris to open their own magazine and do battle with Charlie Hebdo with cartoons, it would be a clash of civilizations, and that would be great. It's too bad they didn't go the cartoon route.
That's right. Oh, we have a question back there. Do we have a mic back there for that gentleman?
Right.
And who else wants to go next? Is there another question after that? So we'll go to you next.
Good evening. My name's Todd Wiggins, and I'm a recovering illustrator, so I wanted to say thank you for your great contributions. One of the things that I notice amongst all four of you is that your style, even though you all have your own specific illustration style that's recognizable amongst all your pieces, that it's pretty much continuous from the time that you started to now. So it seems as though you're doing the same technique that you would have done maybe in the 80s or 90s. Hasn't really changed that much in terms of the way it's done, the craft itself. So do any of you, have you been influenced by anyone, or do you have any sort of mentors that you could look up to that have affected how you develop your own style?
Mine's changed. I mean, my print cartoons, what I showed you, the print cartoons, I mean, that was done in brush and ink. Now I'm basically doing animation with pencil. So no, it's changed. I think we're kind of at the point now. We're not really influenced by anyone. You look at that more when you're younger, I think. You're younger, are you?
Yeah. Well, I could just say a lot of names, but probably nobody would know them because they're very Belgian. But I grew up with things like the Smurfs and things like that. So that was obviously an influence. We had in Belgium, we have the luxury of having a lot of comic strips around. Everybody learns to read from comic strips because we have Tintin, we have Smurfs, and we have Lucky Luke and stuff like that. So it's just there. It's everywhere. You go to the library and 90% is comic books for kids. And if you go, we grew up with magazines, comic magazines. We still have them, Spirou and things like that. It's like Charlie Hebdo, but for kids and without the nudity and the stuff, or with the nudity, but without the penises. And but smart nudity, Smurf nudity. And well, when you grow up with that, and the first thing you do is, I've always wanted to be an artist in some way because of those things, and it's, you copy things. So I have, we didn't buy the Smurfs, we copied them. We made them ourselves, just like a copy machine, but cheaper. And like child labor, really. so we made our own comic books, and we evolved from that. And then in the 90s, The Simpsons came along, and that was a big influence for me as well, because you didn't really have to be a great artist to be funny and to have a message and to be influential. And that was a big influence to me and to my style as well. So, as an artist, I was traditionally schooled in an academy, the Academy of Bruges and Ghent. They are, I don't know, 300-400 years old, so they obviously have some kind of background. And the city where I live in, the cities where I have lived in, is Dürer and Van Eyck, and all these big names are around every corner, and you can just walk into a museum for free because you live there. So that has an immense impact on what you do as an artist.
One of the curious things about this notion of, we're just going to have time for, I think, one more question, but just on this notion of style, is that I like to say is, it's a little bit like when we all learn handwriting, mm-hmm. When we're whatever 6, 7, 8. For the first few days, everyone copies the teacher, and then a week later, everyone copies the kid who's got the coolest handwriting in the class. But then 10 years later, everyone's handwriting is completely different. So part of it is built into your genetic engineering that you're going to come out with something that you can't even control, just finding it. But then again, you are always influenced by those people immediately around you, the Durers, mm-hmm. and so on. I think the curious story would be, is if Anne was born in Belgium, would you be drawing differently? And if mm-hmm. Matt, if you were born in China, would you be born differently? Or how much would it be the same? I don't know. Mm-hmm. But I think that it is an interesting thing that you learn. But at the end of the day, you find your own voice kind of shouts out eventually. So we got...
Well, part of it, too, is it's a compromise of where people are seeing your cartoons. I mean, I remember 20, 30 years ago seeing your stuff in The Economist. Oh. And I was working on newsprint with like lousy printers, and I was so jealous because you were on glossy paper, in color, and all that stuff. And now the thing that's great is that most of our work is seen online on smartphones, mm-hmm. with these beautiful color displays. And it actually has opened up the opportunity to work with a lot of nuance and watercolor and things like that that you couldn't have done 20 years ago, unless you were Cal and worked for The Economist.
But we're also probably viewed by more people around the world today than we were ever before.
Oh, absolutely.
Now that's the other thing, that's the bonus for the... Yeah. But we have, unfortunately, just have time for one more question. And I think I mentioned to you way in the back there, right, that you... And you have the mic there handy? But we're going to... many of us will still be around afterwards. We'd love to meet up if you have any other questions, and we really appreciate your time.
I'm sure I say thank you on behalf of everybody sitting in front of you. But my question is just very simple. You mentioned that some of your colleagues probably contemplated packing up and leaving the industry, and with all the turmoil, it's possible many more may. If you four were told you could no longer do this for a living, what might you consider doing as your encore career?
Ooh la la. Who wants to take that one first? You're going to have more time.
I'd be disabled, probably, because it's the only thing I can do properly. So I have no idea. It's more than just a job. It's an obsession. Mm-hmm. And if I work 6 days a week because the newspaper appears 6 days a week, and the seventh day I'm drawing. I mean, it's like breathing and going to the bathroom. You can't hold up your... for a day. So it's the same with cartooning, basically. And that's if they would fire me, and I've never told the newspaper this, but if they would not pay me, I'd probably work for them anyway.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Yeah. Good job.
That's what we want, that edited out, please.
They're not watching in Belgium.
Matt, what about you?
The same. I would absolutely have to draw. I'd be down in the mall doing caricatures for $5, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I have no other skills.
Yeah, I wouldn't be any. I mean, I honestly cannot imagine not being able to draw.
Yep. And that's interesting because there's the drawing bit, okay? This physical thing, this way of communicating. It's like speaking. It's a language that you learn. You're communicating with... with your hands through these crazy devices. But then there's the other interesting thing is that we have an opportunity for commentary. We have our voices mm-hmm. are heard. Mm-hmm. You know, imagine if because obviously if you're talking about losing our jobs, there's this notion that our voices would have been silenced. And so I think that we probably would have also found a way to get our voice out there in other ways. We might be joining groups or supporting people or taking to play or some other way mm-hmm. to have right. our voices heard.
Graffiti.
And tattoos, right?
Yes,
so I think that we got something there. Well, anyways, thank you all for these wonderful questions. I've been so pleased to be with my colleagues here. It's great to be here at NYU.
Good job, Cal.
Thank you.
Quickly, I have to run.
You have to go
work.
Have a deadline.
You have a deadline.